How much is your right to know worth? For some, it's priceless. But for legislators, it's about $25 an hour, a price that could change a right to a privilege for those with deep pockets. We'll discuss efforts to put a steeper price tag on your right to know and what's being done to stop it now on The State We're In. Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. Recently passed House Bill 1002 would allow public bodies and agencies to charge up to $25 an hour for record searches that take longer than 10 hours, according to the New Hampshire Bulletin. Under the existing Right to Know law, also known as RSA 91A, local and state bodies can charge for copying records, but not record searches. Several New Hampshire news organizations, as well as Right to Know New Hampshire, the New England First Amendment Coalition, the ACLU of New Hampshire, and the Josiah Bartlett Center for Public Policy, urged legislators to reject the bill, calling it a threat to public accountability and transparency. We begin our discussion on the bill and its implications with New Hampshire Bulletin senior reporter Amory Timmons. Amory, can you give us some background on the bill? What would it do?
It's a really dangerous public policy bill. Right now, we use right-to-know requests to get any kind of information. I used one to find out that the state was not really monitoring how it was investing more than $1 million in promoting the vaccine at the start of COVID, for example. They were not measuring that impact at all. I used a right-to-know request to turn up, you know, kind of a questionable land deal in Laconia that's still pending and not moving forward. It's a $21 million land deal that the governor rewrote the law to arrange to sell himself. And because I was able to get right-to-know records, I know there's some problems there with the buyer. So those records requests are really critical to understanding what our government is doing and holding them accountable. If this law goes forward, we will have to pay $25 an hour for each hour beyond 10 hours. So if a request takes 11 hours, I'm going to pay $25 for each hour that they need to find those records. As a nonprofit news organization that doesn't have ads, you know, we get by on donations, we can't afford that. And then how do I hold government accountable? It's just a really bad policy bill. And I think a sign of that is just the group of people that are opposing it. It's news organizations. It's the ACLU. It's the Josiah Bartlett Center, which is on the other side. American for Prosperities, which is very conservative. So I think there's a broad opposition because it is so dangerous.
And just to follow up on that a little bit, and to your point, it's not just news agencies that use this. Can you talk a little bit about, I mean, regular people? What would it be if they had to pay this kind of money, or even nonprofits? Who else uses the right to know most often, do you think?
I think a couple of great examples was we saw a couple use it in Webster. They had a sense that the town had sold a piece of town land very quietly to the treasurer. It was a very valuable piece of land. They sold it for next to nothing. And it was a right to know request that a couple in Webster filed. It took a long time. And sure enough, they uncovered that it had been a very shady sale. And, you know, the government stepped in. That town treasurer now can no longer hold office. And the land deal was reversed. A woman in Nashua has used the right to know request to uncover really improperly inflated tax assessments. And as a result of that, the city of Nashua was forced to redo their tax assessments. I found it interesting that on the House floor, when this passed, a Nashua city official stood up and said, Nashua is an example of how we're doing it right. We don't need this law. And in fact, Nashua has been found in violation of law multiple times, and to the point where a judge has said, you need to get training in the right to know law because you keep violating it. So it really is real people who are using this law.
Absolutely. So can you tell us more about the bill's path through the legislature up until now and what happened last week?
So it was the first LSR filed, and LSR is the first step to a bill. So we saw this come in at the very start of the filing period. It went through a committee, and there was a vote on that. It came to the House floor last week. with the recommendation from committee that it passed, but it was a 12-8 vote. So it seemed like there was maybe potential that it would not get through the House, but it did get through the House. And so we were prepared to go and fight it in the Senate, but a lawmaker asked late Thursday night for it to be reconsidered, meaning it will come back before the House this Thursday. Lawmakers have to consider whether to accept the reconsideration, and if they do, what could be the next steps? I mean, I think the ideal in a lot of our minds would be just to table this bill forever. Perhaps a compromise is to reach some kind of agreement that allows for an exemption, for example, if you're gathering news or information that's in the public interest. So that is to be determined. The first step will be on Thursday to see if lawmakers will even take this up again. From our conversations, it seems hopeful, but we won't know until sometime Thursday.
And just to explain it, so as you mentioned, the bill will come up under reconsideration on Thursday. As we record the show on Wednesday, we don't know the outcome. So can you explain what reconsideration is?
Reconsideration, it's sort of as it sounds. The bill will be called. They'll say, are you open, you know, to reconsidering this bill? A certain representative has requested that. They'll take a vote on whether to reconsider. If they agree to reconsider, then there could be another proposal put forward. Perhaps that is a study committee. Maybe it's tabling the bill. And if it fails, if it's reconsidered and it still passes and heads to the Senate, then we'll have to take our arguments there. So either it can end on Thursday with a study committee or a tabling motion, which would put it to bed for a while, or it gets through and goes to the Senate, and then we restart our negotiations there with the Senate.
And is it unusual for the House to bring a bill back up for reconsideration?
I haven't seen it very often. You'll see it attempted, you know, when a bill fails by a close vote, especially late at night. We saw this a lot with the abortion votes. Can we reconsider that? There were some people in the bathroom or people getting dinner. Sometimes it passes, but I don't see it pass very often. This was a surprise. You know, frankly, when I got a call late Thursday night that a lawmaker intended to file reconsideration, I wasn't expecting that to happen. And so that was a surprise. I think it is really 50-50 whether they actually agree to do it on Thursday.
Thank you so much, Anne-Marie, for joining us today.
Thank you.
Joining me now are Right to Know New Hampshire President Catherine Coco and New England First Amendment Coalition President Greg Sullivan. Catherine and Greg, why are your groups opposed to the bill, and what negative impacts do you think it will have? And Greg, why don't we start with you?
Sure. Thank you. I wrote to the chairman of the Judiciary Committee in the House in January. And I said, this proposed bill is a monumental step in the wrong direction. It will discourage and prevent the citizens from gaining access to public records, which is the opposite result that 91A is intended to effectuate. The way the bill is written, I think it's rampant for abuse. And we've seen over the years that it has often taken, as Anne-Marie mentioned, citizens bringing litigation, in fact, to prove that governmental officials were not properly responding to Right to Know requests. One thing that really jumps out at me about this bill is that a city or town can refer the request to their council. The council may spend hours redacting information that ultimately it can be proven that that information should be available to the citizen, but now we're going to be asking the citizen in advance to pay for the work of the council for the municipality to redact the information that is being sought. And to me, that's just wrong.
And Catherine, how about you? What impacts do you think it will have?
Well, I agree with many of the comments that Mr. Sullivan made. We are very fearful that this bill will deter requesters and really have a chilling effect. I think what's important for people to understand is that the law in New Hampshire is different from many laws across the country in that our Right to Know law is enforced only through individual citizen action. And that whether that's through a request to the ombudsman for review or In court, there is no oversight body to ensure transparency in New Hampshire. And so that falls on the individual. It's very easy for a community to get to that 10 hours. The redactions example was a good one that Mr. Sullivan provided. But it also, I think, by having this law, absolves the public bodies of really understanding decades of case law that have been put together to define what constitutes a reasonable request from the public, what's a reasonable amount of time for a public body to respond to that request, and what constitutes a reasonable search. It takes all of that guidance that exists out there and is not being learned or understood by a public body when they're responding to a right to know request, and instead says, we're not so much interested in what's reasonable within the context of the public interest that's being served and the request that's being made. We're interested in 10 hours being a cap. And I think that that does a tremendous disservice when there is no other mechanism for enforcement in New Hampshire. The other concern we have is that a lot of these examples that are being put forward, first of all, they're far above the 10-hour limit that's being proposed. When you hear some of the examples of large requests, we're not talking 10 hours or more. We're talking 50, 100 plus. And so a lot of these examples also that you hear, especially a few that we heard from one in particular that we heard from the chairman of the Judiciary Committee on the House floor, used an example that is not a realistic example of a request that would be fulfilled. And so there's a lot of conjecture and a lot of anecdotal discussion. The Judiciary Committee, however, did not do any research into what are the reasons for these larger requests? What's driving them? How are they being responded to? And why are people responding to the feedback that they get in the way that they are? And so while this bill was drafted early and was the first bill on the docket, there was no research done into it.
I want to pick up on something you mentioned. So, Catherine, did the passage of HB 1002 seem quick? And what do you think of that process as the bill moved through the House Judiciary Committee and then to the floor for a vote?
So I think it followed the traditional process. What was quick about it was the fact that this was such a substantial issue, and yet the House Judiciary Committee only allocated about 45 minutes for this vote. There was a number of people who were there to testify, and while the first few speakers were given an unlimited amount of time, and that included some that are represent powerful lobbying interests, the majority of the testimony was limited to 3 minutes or less in the interest of moving things towards lunchtime. After that hearing closed, the committee gave it only 2 business days of deliberation before coming back on a Monday and execing and making a recommendation. And that recommendation was split 12 Democrats, 6 Democrats and 6 Republicans to 4 Democrats and 4, four Democrats and 4 Republicans. So it was a very divisive vote. It was acknowledged up front during the executive session that that would be the case. There weren't any questions asked. And I will say that there was no follow-up to our group after that after our testimony and members of our group testified with questions about the impact this would have on the public.
Representative Caitlin Cuttub, the Windham Republican who serves as the bill's primary sponsor, told the New Hampshire Bulletin in November she wanted to address expansive requests that seek hundreds of pages of documents and emails that take hours to fill, often at considerable expense. So here's another question for the two of you. What's your answer to that? Let's start with Catherine and then to Greg.
Well, I think the primary answer is training. There is nothing in the law that requires that any public official in any position be required to understand the right to know law. And I have talked to some of this, particularly one smaller community that has testified to having a very substantial burden of requests, and had a conversation with them about, is your board trained? Is your town manager trained? Do you understand that although you may be getting what feels like a burdensome request, you aren't required to answer every single question that's asked of you? You aren't required to do an exhaustive search. You're required to do a reasonable search. I think that training is incredibly important. And it is lacking across the board at every level of government. I know in my town, even after going through a court process and the ombudsman's office, it took me 2.5 years to convince my local government that they needed to get trained. And that training is available for free if it's taken through the New Hampshire Municipal Association. I think the other issue is we need to understand the root causes of those larger requests, which clearly under the process that we've undergone for this bill, we don't. And I think there are record management solutions that could be put into place. There is one bill in the House right now that looks at alleviating some of the burden of right-to-know requests from municipalities if they are willing to digitize their records and send them to the state archives. And if that bill passes, that will allow those communities to say, thank you for your right to know request. That information is available at the state archives. Here you go. There are a lot of record keeping issues that add to the labor that's involved in having to find information that citizens are looking for. And I think that's an area where we could use a lot of progress.
And Greg, what do you think?
100% in agreement with everything that Catherine just said. Additionally, I think this bill needs to be reconsidered because there are avenues that apparently weren't discussed. For example, what about an indigent person? Are they going to be subject to paying this money that they can't and they don't have? Could we consider the difference between a commercial request that's not in the public interest versus a news organization's request investigating governmental activities? So those are areas that need to be studied and could be acted upon in a more comprehensive and reasoned bill. And to follow up on what Catherine said, I have seen municipalities who's have spent hours and hours looking for records that should have been readily available in either the click of a computer or just with organized records, picking them up from where they should be. So yes, training is very important. Organizing the records to make them accessible, important. But this charging additional monies, I mean, it should be noted that these government officials who are doing the searching, they're doing their job and they're being paid to do their job already. So I hope certainly that this bill is not only reconsidered, but sent back for further study and analysis and improvement.
Sure. And this question's for both of you also. And we've talked about this a bit, but to sum up, is there a compromise between cost and access when it comes to public records? Let's start with Greg and then to Catherine.
There should not be. I represent the New England First Amendment Coalition, and we're familiar with systems where different categories of requestors are charged either different amounts of money or no money in most cases. So the New Hampshire Constitution, Part 1, Article 8, and the Right to Know Law, 91A, there should be no compromise on the fact that these are our records, our the citizens of New Hampshire. They belong to us. They should be accessible to us at all times, and our government should be, accountable at all times. So in that respect, the law is already written and there's no compromise.
Sure. And Catherine, what do you think?
I agree that there should be no compromise on transparency in government and access to it. I think if we're concerned about the costs that we're seeing because of the types of requests and the inaccessibility of information, New Hampshire needs to start looking at those solutions, like I was talking about with digitization as an option, other ways to make records more accessible, and potentially a process that doesn't put the burden of enforcement for transparency 100% on the public. What's happening now is the public is essentially being blamed for fulfilling their role under the way the law is written and the structure is set up. So we want to look at cost and access and balancing them. Then we need to look at how we're running that system, not limit transparency.
And Catherine, in anticipation of reconsideration, what did Right to Know New Hampshire do?
We have reached out individually, electronically, and through phone calls to almost every single member of the state legislature in the last 6 days. We've done email, we've had conversations, we have an op-ed in today's Union Leader as well, talking about the importance of reconsideration. And I am optimistic that People are realizing that there was significant impact to this bill that maybe wasn't as high on the radar as some of the more controversial issues that were before the House last week. So I'm hopeful that we will get a vote for reconsideration.
And if it still passes on Thursday, what's the next step for your groups? Let's start with Greg and then to Catherine.
Well, what NEFAC does is advocates and educates. So we'll have no choice but to continue to advocate for a better right-to-know law than this 1002 bill, which to me is, as I said earlier, a monumental step in the wrong direction.
And Catherine?
We will be appealing to the Senate. We will be asking for amendments to this bill if it gets there. I will say that if this bill passes all the way through the process, I would not be surprised to see a constitutional challenge. There's an argument being made that, you know, the right to information can't be, I believe the language, Mr. Sullivan, correct me if I'm wrong, I believe the language is shall not be unreasonably restricted. And there's a lot of question about whether or not charging a fee creates an unreasonable restriction when there are very few or no other options for accessing information except through individual action.
And just one more question for you, Catherine. If people are hearing this and they feel one way or another about this issue, what is the best way that they can take action or do something?
This is going to be aired after the vote. So I would say as far as the House vote goes, you want to reach out to your legislators. You want to look at how they voted the first time around. If it's trackable, you'd like to see how they voted the second time around, but reach out to your state representatives. And if this is moving on to the Senate, if it does get approved and not reconsidered, reach out to your senators. This is all local. The impact in New Hampshire, we all know, is the local relationships and the local representatives and having those connections in place. So you need to reach out.
Excellent. So we'll be following this issue and hope to have you all back to talk more about it. Right to Know New Hampshire President Catherine Coco and New England First Amendment Coalition President Greg Sullivan, thank you both so much for joining us today. The conversation continues online. How much is your right to know worth? We'd love to hear from you. Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag NHRTK. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.